فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى اله واصحابه والتابعين لهم باحسان الى يوم الدين، اما بعد. ان شاء الله تعالى we're going to take some فرائد and فوائد, some benefits ان شاء الله تعالى, some حكم, some wise statements, some احكام even, some rulings, some sunan and some adab, some manners, some etiquettes, etc. Inshallah ta'ala. So it's going to be different topics all over the place, inshallah ta'ala. The first point, inshallah ta'ala, that I'm going to speak about is min asbabi mahabbati Allah ta'ala. The things that cause the love of Allah. If one wants to gain the love of Allah, what are the things in which if he does, he will gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the statement, a summary of the statement of Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyya rahimahullah in his kitab Madarij al-Salikin. He says it in the third volume, page 17. There are things that if a person does, he will gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first thing is قراءة القرآن والتدبر, reciting the Quran and pondering on it. Reciting the Quran and pondering on the Quran is one of the things that create and causes the love of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah will love you and so will you love Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So it's also from the things that make Allah tabarak wa ta'ala love you. And that's what we're talking about here. What causes Allah to love you? And what can also cause you to love Him? The first one is قراءة القرآن الكريم بالتدبر. Reading in the Quran whilst pondering on it. Number two is التقرب إلى الله بالنوافل. Getting closer to Allah تبارك وتعالى by praying voluntary prayers. التقرب إلى الله بين نوافلي, praying voluntary prayers. Number three is دوام ذكر الله تعالى على كل حال باللسان والقلب والعمل والحال. Is to be consistent in the remembrance of Allah سبحانه وتعالى in all of your situations, on your tongue, in your heart, on your limbs, and in every current situation, whether it's now, whether it is any situation that you're in, remembering Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are three things that if you do, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will love you. Number four, إِثَارُ مَحَابِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى عَلَى مَحَابِ الْعَبْدِ. Placing Allah's love before the love of the slaves and the creation. To give Allah precedence to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala over the creation. Number five, مُطَالَعَةِ الْقَلْبِ لِأَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ. The heart, the person in his heart observing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, his name and his attributes. Observing Allah's names and attributes. Number six, التفكر في آلاء الله ونعمه الظاهرة والباطنة. Thinking and pondering on the blessings of Allah تبارك وتعالى, that which is apparent and that which isn't apparent. The blessings that you can see and the blessings which you can't see. Number seven is انكسار القلب لله تعالى, humbling your heart for Allah تبارك وتعالى, humiliating your heart and yourself to Allah تبارك وتعالى. Number eight, الخلوة بالله وقت النزول الإلهي. Being alone at the time when Allah is descending. Number 9, مجالسة المحبين الصادقين. Sitting with the people who love Allah تبارك وتعالى, who are truthful in their iman and their claim of Islam. والتقاط أطايب ثمرات كلامهم, and to take out from their wise speech that they speak, those people. Number 10 is مباعدة كل سبب يحول بين القلب وبين الله تعالى, to stay away from everything that will get between your heart and Allah تبارك وتعالى. The second benefit inshallah تعالى is going to be من حقوق الله تعالى, the rights that Allah تبارك وتعالى has. The next chapter inshallah. Who could repeat for me the 10 benefits that Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله mentions? The rights, or the thing, sorry, that cause the love of Allah تبارك وتعالى. تفضل.
Number 1, reciting the Quran and pondering on it. It will cause you to love Allah as well as Allah will love you. Getting closer to Allah by praying voluntary prayers. To be consistent in the remembrance of Allah in all your situations, whether it be by tongue, heart, limbs, whether it's now, do it in every single situation. Placing Allah's love before the love of the slave and the creation. The person in his heart observes Allah's names and attributes. Thinking and pondering over the blessings of Allah, that which is apparent and that which isn't apparent. Humbling your heart for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being alone at the time when Allah is descending, sitting with the people who love Allah. They are truthful in their claim of love for Islam, and to take from them their wise speech, and to stay away from everything that will get between your heart and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So those 10 points, does everybody have it?
No.
Now we're going to go into the rights that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has. The first rights that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has is al-ikhlas lahu, sincerity for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Sincerity for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Number 2, sarfi jami' al-anwa' al-ibadati lahum. Diverting every form of ibadah to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Diverting it for him. Number 3, adamu taqaddumi ala amrihi wa nahihi. Do not put anything before Allah's commands and prohibitions. Number 4, إثبات ما أثبته لنفسه ونفي ما نفاه عن نفسه. Affirming for Allah that which he affirmed for himself, and negating from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which he negated from himself. And the fifth one is تعظيم شعائره, honoring his symbols. The شعائر, the symbols of Islam. The symbols of Islam are the things which Allah تبارك وتعالى loves and is pleased with. The second benefit, inshallah ta'ala, is going to be Al-Qur'an al-Kareem, the Holy Qur'an. Point number 1. The Qur'an is Kalamullahi, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Munazzalun ghayru makhluqin. It was sent down and it was not created. Mahfoodun, it's safeguarded and it's protected. من التحريف from distortion والتبديل and changing والزيادة anything being added to it والنقصان and anything being deducted from it. That's the first point. The second point is the reason. The second point is السبب في تحريف الكتب السابقة دون القرآن. The reason why the previous books were distorted and that this Quran will not be is because لأن الله تعالى تكفل بحفظ القرآن, because Allah took it on himself to protect the Quran. قال تعالى, Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. سورة الحجر آية 9. Allah says, we have sent down the Quran and we are the ones who are going to protect it. As for the previous books, Allah placed the responsibility of protecting it إلى العلماء والعباد, upon the scholars and the worshippers. It was their job to protect and to safeguard their books. Under that same topic, under that same heading that you wrote, Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem, write another small subheading, which is من آداب تلاوة القرآن, from the manners of reading the Qur'an. The first one is al-istiyaku. The person, he uses miswak before reading in the Quran. He brushes his teeth. Number two, al-isti'adha. Seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three, البسملة. Say بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. But with the condition, إن كانت القراءة من أول السورة. That's if the recitation is from the beginning of a surah. If it's the beginning of a chapter. You don't say it if you're reading it from the middle. التدبر والتأمل فيما يقرأ. That the person ponders in that which they're going to read. Another small subheading under Al-Qur'an Al-Kareem. The fruits of reading the Qur'an. What are the fruits that a person gets in reading the Qur'an? عبادة يتقرب به العبد إلى ربه. It's an act of worship which the person gets closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one is, it's an act of worship in which the person gets closer to who? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, بكل حرف, every letter, عشر حسنات, you get 10 reward. The second one is, every letter you read, how much reward do you get? You get 10. Number three, تهذيب للأخلاق وتزكية للنفس وتطهير للجوارح. It cleanses your etiquette and your manners. Reading the Quran works on your manners. It also purifies your soul and also purifies your limbs. another very small subheading under Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Some of the names of the previous books. The first one is At-Tawrat, which was given to Nabiullah Musa. The second one is Az-Zabur, was given to Nabiullah Dawood, Az-Zabur. The third one is Al-Injil, and it was given to Nabiullah Isa ibn Maryam. Another small subheading under the Quran al-Kareem. Differences between the Quran and Hadith al-Qudsi. The first one is, the Quran is a mu'jiz. It's a miracle. Hadith al-Qudsi laysa bimu'jiz. Laysa bimu'jiz. It's not a mu'jiz. Number two, muta'abbidun bitilawati. You are worshipping Allah in reciting it. It's an ibadah by reciting the Quran. Hadith al-Qudsi laysa kadhalik. حديث القدسي بكل حرف العشر حسنات. Every letter there's 10 rewards. Sorry, the Quran. Every letter there's 10 reward. حديث القدسي not. Number 4. The Quran, all of it, is متواتر مقطوع بصحته, and its authenticity is without a shadow of a doubt. Hadith al-Qudsi, there's a متواتر. Hadith al-Qudsi, there's those which are ضعيف. Hadith al-Qudsi, there are those which are موضوع. Number 5, the Quran, there's a dispute pertaining to whether you can touch it if you're pure. Some of the fuqaha believe, لا يمسه إلا من كان على طهارة, that you're not allowed to touch the mushaf or even read the Quran if you're not in a state of purity. Hadith Qudsi, ليس كذلك. It's not like that. Another small subheading. The signs of the Meccan surahs. How to identify a Meccan surah? Meccan surah is every surah that came down before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to what? To Medina. It is every surah that came down before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to what? Medina. The first sign to identify a surah that is Meccan, the first one is every surah that has the word kalla, kalla, any surah that has kalla is a what? A Meccan surah. Now all these points that I'm saying, they only got it from the angle of at-tatabbu' wal-istiqra. They followed it up and they realized every surah that had kalla in it, it turned out to be Meccan. Second one is, كل سورة فيها سجدة. Every surah that has a sajda, prostration in it, where you'd have to prostrate. Number three. كل سورة, every surah, قصة آدم, the story of Nabiullah Adam is in there, and Iblis is in there, except Surah Al-Baqarah. Number four. كل سورة, every سورة, أولها حروف التهجي. Every سورة, that the beginning of that سورة starts with حروف المقطع, the disconnected letters, like ألف لام ميم, ألف لام ميم راء, حام ميم, صاد, نون, قاف. How many letters are they? 29 letters, and they start with 14 surahs. صح. 29 letters, and they start with how many surahs in the Quran? 14 surahs. Every surah of those are Meccan surahs because they start with these حروف المقطع, except Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran and Surah Al-Ra'd. Surah Al-Ra'd, there's a khilaf. Surah Al-Ra'd starts with the حروف التهجي. Yeah, but there's a dispute. Surah Al-Ra'd, is it? There's a khilaf. The alamat, the signs of Surah Al-Madaniya, the surahs which are Madani surahs. Number one, the surahs which are Madani. Number one is كل سورة فيها الحدود والفرائض. Every surah that has in it, it has in it hudud, capital punishment, and it has in it fara'id, obligatory things that you need to come with. Number two, كل سورة فيها إذن الجهاد وبيان لأحكام الجهاد. Any surah that permits jihad or even talks about the rulings and the ahkam pertaining to jihad is a Madaniyan surah. Number three, every surah فيها ذكر المنافقين, that the hypocrites are mentioned. إلا سورة عنكبوت. The scholars, they said, pertaining to سورة عنكبوت, قال أهل العلم, the scholars, they said, as a footnote, write this down, أن سورة العنكبوت, that the سورة عنكبوت, and this is the قول المحق تحقيق, the قول which has تحقيق in it, the سورة العنكبوت, the first 11 آية, the first 11 آيات, other than it, other than the first 11, did I say 11? First 11 آيات, other than it is Meccan. Only those 11 are Madinian. The rest is a what? عند التحقيق, according to the قول which is محقق. And in that is where the منافقين were mentioned. In that 11 آيات is where the منافقين were mentioned. Another small subheading under the Quran al-Kareem, the types of stories that are in the Quran. قصص تتعلق بالأنبياء عليهم الصلاة والسلام مع أقوامهم. Stories of prophets with their people. The second one is the stories قصة تتعلق بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Stories that are connected to our prophet Muhammad and his battles. And the third one is stories of بحوادث غابرة وأشخاص لم تثبت نبوتهم. Stories of previous individuals who weren't prophets, or their prophecy is not affirmed in any textual evidence. The benefits that you get, another small subheading. The benefits from the stories in the Quran, the benefits that you get from it. Number one, تثبيت قلب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقلوب أتباعه. Allah, He solidifies and He strengthens the heart of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the heart of his followers. Number two, تصديق الأنبياء السابقين. Belief of the previous prophets. Number three, إظهار صدق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في دعوته بما أخبر له عن أحوال الماضين عبر القرون والأجيال. Proving the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم his truthfulness in his da'wah through the information that was given to him of the previous nations صلى الله عليه وسلم. The last subheading of Al-Quran Al-Kareem is من حكمة تكرار القصة في القرآن الكريم. The wisdom of why the stories were repetitive in the Quran. The wisdom of why the Quran repeats stories many times. The first one is to prove بيان بلاغة القرآن التي هي أعلى مراتب البلاغة. Is the Quran to clarify and to show the eloquency and repetition is from the highest level of eloquency. The second one is قوة الإعجاز. It proves how strong that this Quran is a miracle and that no one can come with the likes of it. في إيراد المعنى الواحد في صور متعددة دليل على غاية الإعجاز. Bringing one meaning in different forms, this is the evidence to show that the Quran is truly a miracle. Number three, الاهتمام بشأن القصة لتمكين عبرها في النفس. Giving importance to to the affairs of the story. So the lessons that are in it are truly rooted in the hearts of the listeners. Because when the story is repeated so many times, it starts to root itself inside you. Number four, اختلاف الغاية. The objectives is different in every time that the Quran mentions the story. The same story, the objectives are different. اختلاف الغاية التي تساق من أجلها القصة ففي كل مقام تبرز المعاني المناسبة له. Every time there is a reason for why it was mentioned, different to the other time when it was mentioned. The next benefit, inshallah ta'ala, is as-sunnah an-nabawiyyah, the Prophet's traditions, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hey, does anyone know what a sunnah is? What's the meaning of the sunnah, linguistically?
Something
means af'al. No, linguistically.
Linguistically,
His path. Ha. The word sunnah linguistically means الطريقة والسير. About الطريقة والسيرة. It means a path. That's what sunnah means, a path. Technically, it means ما ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من قول أو فعل أو تقرير. Technically, it means that which has been transmitted from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in terms of speech, action, consent, and also the scholars they add to it, his features, his sifa khuluqiyya, sifa khilqiyya, sorry, and sifa khuluqiyya. His features and the way he looked, and also his etiquette and manners. What's an example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's speech? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. The hadith of Umar. Verily, every action is what is intended by it. An action would be صفة الصلاة. How the Prophet ﷺ prayed, how he did his wudu, and etc. Those are actions. Taqririyya is that which a Prophet consented to. Like إقرار النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لخالد بن وليد الضبي. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consented and allowed Khalid ibn Walid to eat the lizard. He didn't object to it. Alayhi salatu wa salam. What's the relationship? Another small subheading under the Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah is the main heading. And all of this, inshaAllah ta'ala, is going to all fall under small subheadings that fall under Sunnah al-Nabawi. The heading here right now is the relationship. وظائف السنة مع القرآن. The relationship between the Quran and the Sunnah. Or how the Sunnah serves the Quran. The first one is مبينة موضحة. The first thing that the Sunnah serves the Quran and it does for the Quran is it clarifies it, explains it. Clarification and explanation. As Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He said in the Quran, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. Establish the prayer and give charity. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala also said, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ. Fasting is obligatory on you. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He said, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ. Hajj is obligatory on the people. Does anyone here know how to do Salah, Zakat, Siyam, and Hajj. All four of them. Through the Quran, or does the Sunnah explain all of them?
Sunnah.
The Sunnah. So the ayah here that we have that says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَةِ, establish the prayer. And the ayah which we have that says, وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ, give the zakat. And the ayah that we have that says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ, fasting is obligatory on you. And the ayah that says, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ, all of those ayat are called mujmal. Mujmal means what? They're ambiguous. They don't have any application to it. We can't apply it. Except through what? Until we go to the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And the sunnah came, and what did he do? It clarified for us ahkam al-siyami, the rule is pertaining to siyam, fasting, ahkam al-salati, ahkam al-zakati, ahkam al-hajji. The rulings of each and every one of them were explained for us. So that's the first thing that he does. So the one who says, I take the Quran and I don't pray, take the sunnah, is a liar. And the reality is he can't. So how are you going to implement these verses? You won't be able to. Number two. مُؤَكِّدَةٌ لِمَا جَاءَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. It emphasizes that which has come in the Quran. The sunnah comes, and what does it do? It emphasizes, it draws the same importance to this matter in which the Quran has already done, just by emphasizing it. For example, if you go to Surah Al-Furqan, Ayah 68, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا. This ayah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, the ones who do not associate partners with Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. The siyaq and the context that this ayah came in is talking about the characteristics of who? Ibadur Rahman. Ibadur Rahman's characteristics is that they don't associate partners with Allah. وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرًا وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. And they do not spill the blood, and they don't kill those who which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has prohibited from them, killing them. إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ, except with truth. وَلَا يَزْنُونَ, number three, they don't commit zina. And then Allah after that says, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَٰلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا. Anyone who does all of that will receive a sin for it. And a punishment awaits him. Now we have the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. A person came up to him and he said, أَيُّ الذَّنْبِ أَعْظَمْ. A person came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said to him, أَيُّ الذَّنْبِ أَعْظَمْ. What's the greatest sin? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "An taj'ala lillahi niddan wa huwa khalaqaka." It is to associate partners with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and he created you. What was the first part of the ayah? وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ. So number two is ثُمَّ أَي, the man then said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, then what else?" What's the second worst, the second greatest sin? He said, أَن تَقْتُلَ وَلَدَكَ خَشْيَةَ أَن يَطْعَمَ مَعَكَ. It's for you to kill your child, fear of poverty, or fear that he may eat with you. You think if you have a lot of children, the risk that you have is going to be little. Like, oh, I'm not going to live a good life. I'm not going to have food to eat. So no, you kill the child. Abortion. What was the second point that the ayah said? وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Third one is أَن تَزْنِي أَمَا أن تزاني حليلة جارك. The man said, O Messenger of Allah, ثم أي. What is the third greatest sin? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, for you to commit zina from your neighbors, your next door neighbor, your neighbor, his wife, or his daughters. So here, the third one was what? Zina. Allah said, وَلَا يَزْنُونَ. So the way that the ayah mentioned it, the Prophet came and he emphasized on the same thing. عليه الصلاة والسلام. عليه الصلاة والسلام. Number three. The second way in which the sunnah serves the Quran. The third thing is what? زائدة على ما جاء في القرآن. It adds on to, it increases. The sunnah actually adds on to the Quran. It comes with rulings and things that the Quran hasn't mentioned. And the example for that, ومثال ذلك قوله تعالى في آيات المحرمات من النساء is the verse in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 23. Ayah 23. When Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He spoke about the women that are not lawful for a person to marry. The ayah stops at وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. To combine between two sisters except that which preceded. This is the last one of the people you can't marry. You can't marry your auntie, you can't marry your paternal auntie, your maternal auntie. Are you with me? And he mentions those which you can't marry. But if you look at the ayah, if you look at that ayah, it does not mention, it's not in that ayah specifically, the prohibition of what? A person marrying a woman and her paternal and her maternal auntie. So for you to marry your sister, for you to marry your wife, and her sister, the ayah mentions that. وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ. For you to combine between two sisters, you're not allowed. But the ayah does not mention combining between your wife and her maternal auntie or her paternal auntie. Her auntie from her dad's side or her mother's side. You won't find that in the ayah. Until the Prophet ﷺ's sunnah came and نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الجمع بين المرأة وعمتها والمرأة وخالتها. So this is an additional ruling that you won't find in the sunnah, that you won't find in the Quran. It's an additional ruling that you won't find in the Quran that the sunnah has added onto, which you won't find in the Quran. So if a person leaves off the sunnah, you would see that they would marry what? A girl and an auntie. You see? Number four, the fourth is, وَزَادَ بَعْضُهُمْ مَرْتَبَةً رَابِعَةً, which is, some of them, they increase a fourth point, which is, وَهِيَ أَن تَكُونَ نَاسِخَةً لِحُكْمِ الْقُرْآنِ, that the Qur'an can be abrogated. By who? The sunnah can abrogate the Qur'an. The sunnah can come and what can it do? It can abrogate the Qur'an. The example for that is Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 180. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذَا حَضَرَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ إِن تَرَكَ خَيْرًا الْوَصِيَّةُ لِلْوَالِدَيْنِ. The ayah here says, it is كُتِبَ, it is made obligatory, that if one of you, death is going to come to him. إِن تَرَكَ خَيْرًا إِن تَرَكَ خَيْرًا الْوَصِيَّةِ, that the person leaves behind a wasiyah, written wasiyah, لِلْوَالِدَيْنِ, for your parents. Wasiyah means what?
A will.
A You write a will for your parents. The Sunnah came and he abrogated that ayah. By saying what? إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَعْطَى كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهُ. Allah has given everyone their rights. فَلَا وَصِيَّةِ لِوَارِثٍ. There is no will for the person who's already going to inherit you. What's the point? Your parents are going to inherit you regardless. Whether you write a will for them or not. But before, you'd have to write a will for them. That ayah now is what? Abrogated by what?
Sunnah.
The question arises, which is a side benefit, inshallah ta'ala. Can the Quran abrogate the Sunnah? Can the Quran abrogate the what?
Sunnah.
Hey, what do you guys think? If we've said right now that the job of the Quran, the job of the Sunnah is to clarify the Quran and it serves the Quran, then it can't abrogate it. As Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he said, Inna nahnu, to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we sent down the Quran on you, Muhammad, so you can clarify it. The abrogation is a form of clarification. So the Quran can't abrogate the Sunnah, but the Sunnah can abrogate the Sunnah can abrogate the Quran. Another small subheading, inshallah ta'ala. The reason, this one inshallah ta'ala, this small subheading is, and this is probably a question that you guys might ask yourselves. All of this falls under the subheading under what?
Sunnah
Nabawiyyah. That sometimes you might find one hadith and it has different wordings. Why? Why does one hadith have different riwayat? وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ لِمُسْلِمٍ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ صحيح؟ So this one is asbab. What are the reasons of تعدد الروايات? The difference of riwayat, narrations. في الحديث النبوية الشريف. The first one is تعدد الحادثة. The situations are different. Sometimes the Prophet said it like this and sometimes he said it like this. Number two, الرواية بالمعنى. Riwayatul bin ma'na means the hadith is narrated by meaning. The sahabi does not mention the hadith by the Prophet's wordings. He will only narrate it by what? By the meaning that the hadith carries. So the wordings will slightly be different. Number three is ikhtilaful qudrata ala al-hifz. The ability of memorization differs from person to person. Yeah? The fourth one is اختصار الراوي للحديث. The narrator, he summarizes on the hadith only. Number five, حضور الراوي بعض الحديث. The narrator is only there for some of the narration. Number six, تعدد الإجابات. The answers are different from person to person. Number seven, al-khata, mistakes sometimes. Number eight, al-kadhib, lying. Somebody's lying. Another small subheading. As-Sahaba to the companions. Number one. The companions, who are they? And what are they? قَوْمٌ إِصْطَفَاهُمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى لِصُحْبَةِ نَبِيِّهِ. They are a people Allah chose for them to accompany the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number two, لَهُمْ فَضْلٌ, they have virtue. لَا يَلْحَقُ مَنْ بَعْدَهُمْ مِنْ سَائِرِ النَّاسِ. They have a virtue that no one after them will ever reach. بُغْضُهُمْ, hating them. Or بُغْضُ بَعْضِهِمْ, or hating some of them, is a خَلَلٌ عَظِيمٌ فِي الْعَقِيدَةِ. It's a big deficiency in your عقيدة. Number four, مَحَبَّةٌ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ, loving them is إيمان. Loving them is إيمان. وَبُغْضُهُمْ مِنَ النِّفَاقِ, hating them is from hypocrisy. Number five, أفضلهم أبو بكر, the most virtuous from amongst them is Abu Bakr. ثم عمر بن الخطاب, and then عمر بن الخطاب. ثم عثمان, and then after that عثمان. ثم علي بن أبي طالب, and then after that علي ابن أبي طالب. A small subheading. العشرة المبشرون بالجنة. The 10 who were promised Jannah alive. The first one is Abu Bakr As-Siddiq رضي الله تعالى عنه. The second one is Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله تعالى عنه. The third is Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number four is Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number five is Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn Jarrah رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number six is عبد الرحمن ابن عوف. عبد الرحمن ابن عوف رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number seven is الزبير بن عوام رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number eight is طلحة ابن عبيد الله رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number nine is سعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله تعالى عنه. Number 10 is سعيد بن زيد رضي الله تعالى عنه. Those are called العشرة المبشرون بالجنة. The 10 who were promised Jannah alive. It doesn't mean that they were the only 10 promised Jannah alive, by the way. There were others who were promised Jannah alive, but the reason why they were called the 10 promised Jannah alive is because they were all mentioned together in one hadith. The Prophet named them like this. The Prophet said, Abu Bakr is in Jannah, Umar is in Jannah, Uthman is in Jannah, Ali is in Jannah, Abu Ubaid Amr al-Jarrah is in Jannah, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is in Jannah, Zubair ibn Awam is in Jannah, Talha ibn Ubaidillah is in Jannah, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas is in Jannah, and Sa'id ibn Zayd is in Jannah. The Prophet named them like that. So that's why they are called the 10 who were promised Jannah.